You got your reward.
Saints of God, we've got a warning for you today. If you're looking for the praises of God, Jesus said these sad, sad words. You've already got your reward. I'll tell them the story.
Pharisees stood on the streets when they prayed.
Hello, I'm Dr. Jeremy Flowers, and I want to welcome you to another episode of Good News from the Grave. We invite you to a time of biblical information and inspiration. We invite you to this morning's broadcast, as is currently in progress. Meet me if you would. I'm going to ask that you work with me this morning as the Holy Spirit works in me. I was in Toledo last night, say amen when you can. I got back this morning at about 10:12 a.m. Yeah. But there's a word from the Lord. John chapter 8. Yeah. Deacon Clark is already hot here, so prayerfully the sermon getting hotter. John chapter 8. We're tabernacle there in the first verse. John chapter number 8, tabernacling there at verse number 1. If you were here on last Lord's Day, you know we dealt with John chapter 8, verse number 31 and following, when Jesus says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Later on saying, if the Son sets you free, then you are free indeed. In evening service on last Sunday, we looked at John chapter 8, verses 37 and following, when Jesus is dealing with the Jewish leaders and telling them that their father is the devil, and the devil is a murderer and a liar, and when Satan his native tongue, which is lying. All of that is good stuff. And last week we benefited from the fruit of John chapter 8. But all that preaching, I said I gotta go back to the root if you can shout about the fruit. And the root is in John chapter 8, verse number 1. There, John, the intimate friend to Jesus the Christ, chronicles a dialogue whose primary character is Jesus, though the primary beneficiary is the woman. The Bible says, but Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. At dawn, he appeared again in the temple courts, where all of the people and all swarms of people gathered around him, and he sat down to teach them. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman overtaken and or caught in adultery. The Bible goes on to say they made her stand before the group and or they made her stand in plain sight. Verse 4, they then said to Jesus, Master and or teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery in the very act. Now before you speak, Jesus, verse number 5, in the law, Moses commanded us to stone such a woman or a woman like this. Now, what do you say? They were using this question as a trap in order to have a basis or grounds for accusing him. But Jesus bent down and started to write on the ground with his finger as if he did not hear them. When they kept on accusing and or questioning and or badgering him, depending on your version, he straightened up and said to them, let any one of you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her. Again, he stooped down and wrote on the ground. At this, those who heard this after being convicted by their own conscience began to walk away one at a time. The older ones fell. Let somebody with gray hair say amen. Until only Jesus was left with the woman standing there. Jesus straightened up and asked her, woman, one condemn you? No one, sir, she said. Then neither do I condemn you. Go now, or from now, go and leave your life of sin. I'm oscillating and vacillating between several different topics for today. Therefore, I want to talk for a little while around the thought, our Messiah's greatest miracle. Our Messiah's greatest miracle. Subtopic, a woman of few words. Our Messiah's greatest miracle, a woman of few words. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Let us go to God in prayer. Dearly, kind, and gracious Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for what was, what is, and what will be if we keep our hand in your unchanging hand. Father God, be with everyone under the sound of my voice. Father, open their minds, their hearts, their spirits, their souls, and yes, even their ears, to hear a word coming straight from you via your manservant. Father, it is you, it is your Holy Spirit that allows any man to preach on your behalf. And if any man speak, let him speak as if the oracles of God. Father, I shouldn't be here, not of my own accord. But Father, I pray now that you use me as your instrument and play me masterfully. Forgive me of all of my sins, Father. And Father, upon my repentant heart, please pen the words you once said to your servant and through your servant. Father, bless the word. Father, bless your servant. Father, bless us all as your children. All these things we ask in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Our Messiah's greatest miracle. Subtopic, a woman of few words. I submit to you this morning for your spiritual consideration and elucidation that the greatest instance within this text is not a miracle performed, but rather a life come for. Wow. The greatest revelations brought forth by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in his public ministry was not when he turned water to wine, but rather when he turned a cheater into the chosen. Somebody missed your shout at 11:09. The greatest revelation was not when Jesus turned water to wine, but rather when he turned a cheetah into the chosen. And in turn gave a mistress a ministry, thereby concentrating a side chick to her main focus. And the main focus that is evident throughout John chapter 8 is that Jesus is the light, Jesus is the truth, and Jesus is a liberator. And whoever believes in him will not die but have eternal life if they die to self and live for Christ. And as this text poignantly proves, that the time to live for Jesus the Christ is in fact right now. For there is a future even on the other side of failure. And if you get nothing else, you can write this down with a pen, a pencil, a crayon, some eyeliner, put it on Facebook and Instagram and Twitter and Snapchat, so snap this up. There is a future on the other side of failure. And the same way that the Jews were able to put down their stones is the same way that you and I can put down our sinful lives right now and live for Jesus the Christ. I don't know about you on this morning. I don't know about your ideology or even your theology. But I am a firm believer that Jesus is still in the miracle business. I am a firm believer that Jesus is still in the miracle business. And if to that you're looking for a meaning, just go and find yourself a mirror.
Right.
If in miracle in your reflection, then you will remember how Jesus the Christ himself took a sinner like me, yeah, and he informed me, conformed me, and transformed me. Peach flowers, I think how we are. And if you can't find no other miracle, I know that this in fact is a miracle. And not only is it a miracle, but rather it's Jesus' greatest miracle.
Yeah.
And the fact that Jesus saved me,
yes,
even me,
yes,
or the fact that Jesus, for somebody today, wants to intervene into your life,
yes,
and save you.
Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, that is Jesus' greatest,
yeah,
miracle.
Amen.
As one meticulously marks the messianic miracles in the Gospel of John, one would see that the preponderance of public messianic miracles occurs before this text, with only the healing of the man born blind and the raising of Lazarus from the dead coming after this text. But it's here in John chapter number 8 that Jesus appears to put phenomena on pause. But I submit to you this morning that Jesus paused for a purpose.
Wow.
He put his fish and hush puppy buffet on a brick.
Wow.
He put his intercession on interlude.
Wow.
His revivals on respite and his healings on hiatus.
Wow.
And here he focuses our attention to his greatest miracle that while he exhibited in this woman, it extends even to our life. May I submit to you this morning that Jesus' greatest miracle is not supernatural, but rather it's a miracle whenever he does something super, even with our natural. For it was while I was in my nature that I used to cook, but God did something super with my natural. And now the difference that I see in my life is because of Jesus and that supernatural.
Right.
In my nature, I used to smoke.
Yeah.
In my nature, I used to participate in immoral acts of sex.
Yeah.
In my nature, I used to lie.
Yeah.
In my nature, I used to cheat.
Yeah.
In my nature, I used to steal. In my nature, I used to commit adultery. I wish I had somebody in here.
Yeah.
And it's funny how we love to talk about fornication, but nobody in the church wants to talk about extramarital affairs.
Yeah.
We love talking about premarital sex, but nobody ever says a word about extramarital sex. Preach powers, I'll preach all by myself if I have to. Church restoration is the Messiah's greatest miracle.
Yeah.
Redemption is the Messiah's greatest miracle. Salvation is the Messiah's greatest miracle.
Yeah.
Sanctification is the Messiah's greatest miracle.
Yeah.
A second chance and a third chance and just having another chance is the Messiah's greatest miracle. Well, I gotta see it for myself. Haven't you lived long enough?
Yeah.
You stop having to see a miracle and you'll start being a miracle.
Right.
For Jesus miraculously saves us by his blood, which is shed because of his love. Why God grace? Grace is good. And grace has gotten you to this point. Love holds you in this point. Now what will you do from this point? There are many who are smarter than I am, who believe that while this text is an actual occurrence of non-fiction, that this discourse does not find its course in this particular pericope of scriptures. They claim that it's in the wrong place and that copyists and transcribers put it in the wrong chapter. I disagree with that from the standpoint that John's entire narrative in John chapter 8 has seeds in this pericope, thus making this salvation encounter the root that bears fruit in the rest of our text.
Yeah.
Jesus being the light of the world, verse number 12, leaps out to me from this text. The fact that Jesus will later say in this chapter that if one does not believe in me, then they will die in their sins, that leaps out to me in this text. The fact that Jesus says in verse number 51 that whoever obeys my word will never see death leaps out to me from this text. Jesus being a liberator by the way of truth leaps out to me in this text. Jesus' ongoing struggles with the Jewish leaders that's permeated in jealousy and envy leaps out to me from this text. So since all of these poignant points leap from this pericope, let us leap into this pericope to see where we fit in God's scheme of redemption. For God has worked many miracles. But the greatest miracle he has ever worked is in me. Now that we have preheated the oven, let's get cooking. John chapter 8, verse number 1. John chapter 8, verse number 1. I believe verse number 1 begins with a transformative conjunction, but. For those of us who love grammar, we know that sentences cannot begin with conjunctions. Therefore, I need to go back and grab John chapter 7, verse number 53. Oh, if I had time, I would tell you, that's why we call it pericope. It's not just to say a fancy $5 word, but every thought does not fit in every paragraph. Every thought does not fit in every chapter. The original transliteration didn't even have chapters.
Right.
You would say, well, why is it beginning with a but? But what? Well, but what is established in John chapter 7? In John chapter 7, they're continuously trying Jesus without a trial. It is Nicodemus who says in the end of John chapter 7 that this is not how we conduct business. We always give people a fair hearing and a fair trial. When Nicodemus comes forth with this nugget of truth, ain't nobody interested in trying Jesus no more. So the Bible says in John chapter 7 that they all went to their own home. Then verse number 1 says, but Jesus went, to the Mount of Olives. Why? Because he ain't have no home. That's why he tells the one who wants to follow him, wherever he goes, he says, look here, you don't know what you're asking for.
Right.
Foxes have holes and birds in the air have nests, but what? The Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. We just had some drama and a situation go on. Everybody went home with me.
All right.
I went to the Mount of Olives.
Well,
yeah. Owen, this ain't part of my sermon, but if I had some time, I would tell you, the man who had no home on earth is currently preparing our home in glory. John chapter 14, verses 1 and 5. But he went to the Mount of Olives. Verse number 2. At dawn, he appeared again in the temple courts. Dawn here from the Greek speaks of daybreak.
Right.
It speaks of early, early in the morning.
Yes.
It's amazing that here that Jesus as the light of the world comes as the light after the night. To bring light even to the whole world. I'm so glad that when I was living in darkness, it was Jesus who brought me light.
Yeah.
It showed me who he was.
Yeah.
And told me the right way to go.
Yeah.
It's amazing that at dawn, Jesus comes as the light after the night. To bring light to the whole world.
Yeah.
But here Jesus proves that not only is he the light to the world who appears alongside the light of the atmosphere, but here he shows us that he can illuminate even our dark spaces once we bring our darkness in the presence of his light. I'm preaching already, you don't even know it. At dawn, the Bible says he appeared in the temple courts. Appearing again means this is a common custom. The temple where we're focused today, ironically, is the temple of women. And it's amazing that here in the temple of women that he would free a woman who normally would not even be welcome in the temple. Thus proving that all sinners have a place in the sanctuary all because of the Savior. But he's to him, even to the point of trampling each other. The Sermon on the Mount proves that he could get a large crowd. Mark chapter 1 says people came to him because they craved his teaching, because he spoke as one with both power and authority. Oh, if I had time, child of God, I would tell you that the only thing that grows a church is good teaching. In today's time of Christian or congregational competition, folks think they can do everything else to grow a church. If they have the best music ministry, if they have the best children's facilities, child of God, can't nothing replace teaching. People knowing they hear red, and people knowing they hear lies. Bad time for a commercial break. If perchance you're choosing a church, you're here today in the audience, or you're listening on the radio, or wherever you may hear this lesson on YouTube or on Facebook, you better find yourself in a church that teaches the truth. What makes the difference between one church and the next is, in fact, the teaching. These folk were so anxious for the Barry to be taught that later on we see when Thomas doubted Jesus, that Thomas missed the first evening service. He couldn't come at 6 o'clock p.m. But these folk are here at dawn. They come to Sunday school. Because they know that there's something that they need in their life, and they can only come from a man named Jesus. At dawn, the people gathered around him. And he did what? He sat down to teach them. He what? Sat down. I need you to notice, child of God, throughout this text, not only where Jesus is spiritually, but where he is spatially. I need you to see what he's doing throughout the text. For my note takers, he sits down to teach. He stands to listen. He stoops to write, and then he stands to encourage. But he sat down to do what? Teach him. He didn't sit down to do a praise break. He didn't have to have the whole band and orchestra. He didn't have to have a multi-million-dollar facility. He didn't have to serve breakfast to get folks to come. He was teaching in verses 1 and 2. But it's once he was forced from his classroom that this teacher taught the greatest lesson. And that lesson is that man can be forgiven by God and through God even when they are caught and guilty. Not because God condones it. But by grace. Well, I just don't like this chapter. Because all he says is go and sin no more. I feel like something ought to happen. I feel like she ought to be punished. You ever met some church folk like that? They always want something for somebody else that they don't want themselves. Let me tell you something. Jesus gave her emancipation with expectation. That's why he said, go and sin no more. Verse number 3. I ain't a long way to go in a short time to get there. Verse number 3. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman caught in adultery. Let's see if we get through that. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees. Same haters, different day. they're jealous because people have left their teaching and flocked after this man named Jesus. They spend the preponderance of the Gospel of John trying to disprove him before the people. The sad thing is, these are religious people who brought this mess into a religious place. So, the religious leaders, the Pharisees and the scribes, brought in. Another way to say that is, they bogarted this woman in the middle of his assembly. He's teaching in perfect peace, serenity, and tranquility. But here they come. His instruction was interrupted by their incredulous investigation and uninvited interrogation. They don't care about hope being taught. They don't care about hope growing. That's what some church folk do. Some church folk bring stuff in the church that has nothing to do with growing other folk. But that's not in my notes, so I better keep moving. They brought in a woman. They brought in a woman caught in adultery. This had to be the worst day of her life. So sometimes we preach this from a superficial 40,000 foot perspective. Put yourself, put your sanctified imagination into the framework of this woman. This had to be the worst day of her life. But what she didn't know, and what they didn't know, but what we now know, is that even though this was her worst day, they actually brought her to the best place. I find it amazing that many people who are in sin or who are caught up in sin will then take that as an opportunity for them to run from Jesus and the church. But that's when we need him most. That's why we serve a God who says, cast all your cares upon me. They are trying to kill her. And they end up saving her. You ever had a hate in your life? That hated you so much, they ended up loving you anyway?
Hallelujah.
They brought her to the feet of Jesus. Church, if there ever is a time when you think I am in sin, when you are ready to give up on me, please bring me to the feet of Jesus. Don't bring me to the seat of your expectation. Don't bring me to the seat of your criticism. Don't bring me to the seat of your pseudo-psycho concern, but rather bring me to the seat at the feet of Jesus. Because he is the only judge, and he's the only one who can give me a fair hearing. I don't want to hear about what you would have done. If you would have done it, you would have done it a long time ago. Somebody said, go back to Toledo, Flowers. I'm here now. Understand. Can I be real with you? Can I be transparent? If you're visiting, we're transparent people.
Yes, sir.
Well,
we look at her and say, for shame. When the shame is ours.
Yes. Right.
Amen.
We all got something that we do in private. And the only reason some of us ain't met Jesus is because we haven't got caught. Regardless of being caught or not, he at the same time made me innocent.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was at the same time he found me guilty that he simultaneously made me innocent. That's why he went up Golgotha's hill. That's why he hung on the cross. That's why he had three nails pierced in his flesh so I could be forgiven. Because Jared and Mary and Leo and Curtis and Rhonda, they were guilty. But I'm the one who's going to make them innocent.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
This pre-cross narrative establishes that if Jesus forgives you, then you are forgiven. That's why later on Jesus will say, if the Son sets you free, then you are free indeed. And I must not get to the woman. All right. That was much fun this morning.
All right.
They brought in a woman. Now. I know what all the women are about to say.
Where was he?
It always happens like this. It's always a woman's fault. Ain't nothing a woman could ever do to be innocent. If a woman dresses not with all her clothes on, it's her fault. If a woman puts all her clothes on, it's still her fault. Why can't men control themselves? It's not fair that it's the woman. Now hold on. They brought in a woman. This is interesting. As it pertains to gender and number.
Wow.
Number because it's one instead of two.
Yeah.
And adultery is still one of those sins that it takes to the table.
Yeah. Right.
I'm trying to keep it PG, y'all to help me. This woman in our text is nameless, but from here she becomes famous.
Yeah.
The man is not present, we know this. Number one, he may be part of the set.
Wow.
Or number two, he might not just be valuable to their agenda and their ulterior motive.
Right.
But in either case, the woman was the popular target. Why? Because women had no value.
Right. Right.
And in this patriarchal society, they were nothing more than just possessions.
Right.
But it's here and throughout the 3.5-year public ministry of Jesus, that Jesus will prove and provide that women have value.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he'll even take them as his own possession, as quoted in Galatians chapter 3, verse number 24, when Paul reminds us that they're male and female, and they're both in Jesus the Christ.
Right.
Yes, sir. If I had time to talk about women's suffrage, I would tell you that Jesus was one of the first feminists.
Yes.
Long before there was feminism.
Yes.
But this woman was what? Caught or overtaken in adultery. Caught or overtaken. The Greek here for caught means to have something lay hold of you.
All right.
For it to take possession of you.
Well, right.
And seize you and render you conscienceless. This woman was not just casually sinning. It had taken a hold of her. This had become her predicament and her lifestyle. She got caught up. Am I talking to anybody who's ever been caught up? You're entangled. You're enraptured.
Yeah.
Something's laid hold of you. It's taking possession of you. Now, I know all of y'all primitive proper this morning, and you say, well, child of God, you know, when I sin just a little bit, and I sin every now and then. I'm a casual sinner. Nothing takes control of me like that. Well, you do what you do. I'm going to talk about what I've been through. The fact of the matter is, sometimes sin it gets you caught up.
Right.
Sometimes sin gets you caught up to the point where you don't even feel that you're caught up.
Right.
That's why you say foolishness like, I can stop anytime I want to.
Yeah.
She's caught up in adultery.
Yeah.
we've all been caught up.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Yeah. More than once.
I'm going to let Peter get his praise on. And can I tell you something? Not only have we all been caught up, even if you haven't had sex, you've committed it, don't you?
Yeah.
And if you've never had sex, you committed adultery. Adultery is from the standpoint of violating a covenant with another who has no interest in the first covenant. I believe that when I sin, we know that we break our covenant with God, who has sought us and bought us, and we belong to another who has no interest in the first covenant. And that's why a lot of us have learned that the grass is not greener on the other side.
Right. Right.
So this woman, like us, have been caught up. And if we have been caught up in sin, we've lived adulterously before. Okay, you don't like that? I believe the Old Testament, God tells Israel that they were a whoring before him.
Right.
So we can have that type of relationship. This woman. Put yourself back in her framework. Picture her embarrassment. She had to be caught and then brought in a way to convey to her new audience at the temple that she was in fact caught. And what they took her while she was in adultery. The Bible says, in the very act. PG. She was in the middle of being in the middle. You have to figure if they're trying to capture to the audience that they captured her in adultery. There was no time to get her properly dressed and arranged together. They didn't let her put her foundation on first. She couldn't arch her eyebrows. They took her from where she was. They said, baby, leave your Mac and your Avon and your Medicaid on the counter. If you get yourself a towel, you'll be all right. Because you got to go somewhere, and it really ain't got nothing to do with you. She was caught in the act of adultery. Bro. Before the people. They made her stand before the group. It's one thing to be alone. It's another thing to be naked and alone. It's another thing to be naked and alone and have all your business displayed. Not from your own mouth, but from the mouth of a stranger. That's where this woman is. And a lot of us can identify with her this morning because we have been embarrassed too by our past or possibly our present. Folk who know about our situation, who call themselves religious. Because these Pharisees and scribes didn't catch her in the temple. They caught her in the bedroom. And folk who ought to be religious should have been able to restore her where she was. And build her back up and bring her back to God. Oh, but you need to know the fact that there are some people, even in the church, who ain't out for your good. We talked about a few weeks ago how love covers a multitude of sin. If you love me, you ought to be able to cover me so that what's concealed don't have to be revealed.
Right.
But these church people care nothing about her. Folk who should have been religious. Spent more time revealing her instead of restoring her. I don't know about you. I'm having a Rodney Sparks moment. As I look at this woman, I know it could have been me. It should have been. Not just because of my sexual immorality, They brought her to this place. They didn't know they were bringing her to the best place.
Amen.
God can use your enemies for your escape.
Right.
She's caught in adultery. It's amazing that we know what she did, but we don't know why she did it. We don't matter what wrong is wrong. Hold on, wait a minute. Can I tell you something? Everybody in here does or has done something to self-soothe through your situation. Everybody in here, you got something to self-medicate.
Right.
Everybody in here, like Job, has cut themselves with some pottery. I just know what you, I don't care why she did it. I don't believe in excuses, but I do believe in reasons. We all got reasons. We all got rationale for why we are what we are and why we act how we act. That don't make an excuse if it's a reason. See, people who are really out for your restoration, they not only want to see what you did, they care why you did it. It's one thing to say, well, you're just so promiscuous. You ought to stop being too hot to try. Maybe somebody ought to say, why? Let's deal with the root behind this fruit.
Right.
If you got to get licked up every Friday just to make it through Saturday, somebody who loves you ought to be able to ask you why.
Right.
If you're always going to lie, always going to cheat, always going to steal, always going to be insecure, always going to have all this drama around you, always going to have a pity party, somebody ought to ask the question why. But I'm so glad that I have a God who can fix the what even without the why.
Right.
Okay. So this woman is here. And she's caught in the act of adultery. And in verse number 5. That's some good stuff about grace. I'll do that tonight. Verse number 4. In verse number 4. They say to him, after they make her stand in plain sight, Master, King James, or teacher, NIV, this woman was caught in the act of adultery in the very act. Jesus says, I'm glad you called me teacher. Now act like a student. But this woman was caught, overtaken, entangled, interrupted. It took possession of her. She was caught in the act of adultery in the very act. She was in the middle of being in the middle. He saw it, they saw it. Now, we set this whole thing up for you. We got the evidence. It ain't circumstantial. It ain't hearsay. This ain't law and order. This ain't NCIS. We saw it. We got the evidence, and we got the verdict. And we even got legal precedent. Have you ever had somebody in your life who they, all they had to do was help you, but they were so intent on hurting you that they had already set up everything about you without even talking to you? They already had the verdict down, the evidence down, the guilt down. Everything was already lined up. When they come to Jesus, all they want is a sentence. But I'm so glad that Jesus does not sentence me as my enemies think of me.
Man.
This one was caught the act of adultery in the very act, verse number 5. In verse number 5, let me give you the legal precedent. So now these Jewish leaders turn from being pitiful to being prosecutors to being paralegals. They ain't got the case study. She was caught having adultery in the very act. Before you talk, let me give you the legal precedent on the matter. In the law, in the Torah, in Clyde's favorite word, the Pentateuch.
Yes.
Moses, who we know, because we don't know you. It was Moses who wrote the law. It was Moses who, when Pharaoh was behind us in the Red Sea, was in front of us parting the waters. We know what Moses can do, but we don't know you. If Jesus felt like talking, he would say, hold on, wait a minute. You must understand that it was by my outstretched hand that the Red Sea opened up. And yes, Moses wrote it, but me, my Father, and my Holy Spirit were there guiding his hand. But that's another topic for another time. In the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. Stone is a continuous Greek phrase meaning stone until dead. It is the most brutal of capital punishment. Because we're pelted till we die, usually from internal bleeding. But also because we have to see the person killing us. In the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. Or, the best translation says, a woman like this. What you mean like this? A woman like this, this type of woman, ought to be stoned. Don't nobody deserve to die who God died in order to make live.
Yeah.
And that includes us.
Yeah.
Some of us think just like the Pharisees and the Jewish leaders. That's what happens to those type of people. Yeah. Who you think you are?
Right.
You are those people.
Yeah.
I can't say that, but I sure want to. To stone such a word. Now, what do you say? All eyes on you, Jesus. What you got to say? They were looking for a saying from Jesus.
Right.
Wow.
But Jesus, in fact, gave them a word.
Yeah.
A word that blessed them then and blesses us now.
Amen.
And that is while sin is not condoned, it's because of Jesus that sin no longer has control.
Yeah. Yeah.
They were using this question as a trap to him. Meaning what? They were looking for something that they could hold on Jesus. Something they could hang on his ministry. They wanted a basis or grounds for accusing him. They had to accuse him because the people fell in love with him. Why did the people fall in love with him? Because he hung out with people who they would deem as such people. He hung with tax collectors and sinners. He hung with women who were known for promiscuity. He hung with the vagabonds of society. Can I tell you something? As we begin to land this plane, the closer you are to Jesus will determine the closer you are to people who don't look like Jesus. If you really want to be like Jesus, go hang out with some folks who don't know Jesus and don't look like Jesus. So they can look like Jesus.
Amen.
A preacher's not a preacher because he smells good in his cologne.
Wow.
A preacher's not a preacher because he drives a fancy car.
Yeah.
A preacher's not a preacher because he lives in a nice house. But it's time for the man of God and everybody else who claims to love God to every now and hang out around some folks who don't know.
Right.
Every now and then, it's okay to smell like cigarettes. Smell like weed. Smell like crown of oil. Okay, now what? I don't know why you're looking at me funny. I smell all three of those things in this church. Say amen to that. Come here, smell like trees. Ain't no forest outside. They were looking for a reason. we're all a work in progress. We all owe it somewhere from somewhere. That's what they say, amen. If you don't like it, call customer service. Now, they're trying to chop it. This woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the very act, in the law, Moses tells us to stone such a woman. Now what do you say? This is a catch 22, because no matter what you say, we got you. We got you by popularity and politically. We have you ideologically and institutionally. All right. If you come out here and say stone her, then the people gonna hate you. Because you say you came to here for life and life more abundantly. That does not fit into your ideology. But if you say to not kill her, then you violated institutionality, which says that she must die. What you gonna do about your popularity, Jesus? You gonna kill her or not? If you kill her, you won't be popular. If you don't, you won't be political. We got you legally. Legally, if you kill her, you violated Roman law, because Roman law does not allow Jews to carry out their own capital punishment. If you don't kill her, you violated Jewish law, because Jewish law says in Leviticus and Deuteronomy that such a one is to be stoned. Now, I do know that I don't have time to explain that Leviticus and Deuteronomy, in both of those laws, it says the man and the woman should be taken outside the city and stoned. We know that the man's not there. I only have enough time to concentrate on the woman. What you gonna do, Jesus? He don't say nothing, but he writes everything. But Jesus is good preaching. I can't preach like I want to. Big die, another spatial transfiguration. He went, sat down, stood up, sat down, stood up. He bent down, started to write on the ground with his finger. What ground is powerful here? Ground speaks of animal land. Land that can be planted upon. I find it amazing that Jesus writes to deposit a word into the ground. The same type of ground that can bring forth a harvest.
Yeah.
He wrote on the ground with what? His finger. That tells me that whatever he's writing has to be precise.
Yeah.
In nature. Wow. Remember that. Verse number 7. In verse number 7, the Bible says, when they kept on questioning him or pestering him, or burdening him, meaning what? They go on and on and on and on. Jesus is saying, I don't want to get part of this foolishness. I'm going to start writing on the ground. They say, no, no, no. And then how this going to work? Jesus, say something, Jesus. Everybody here, Jesus. We got embarrassed. We finally got you. We've been trying to track you since John chapter 1. What you going to say? What you going to do? Everybody's here now. What you got to say? You can turn water to wine, but you ain't got no answer. You can feed 5,000 a little boy. Turn around and feed another 4,000. What you gotta say now? You can heal them, know them, and stuff. What you gonna do now? Say something. I'm so glad that Jesus is silent when my haters are talking. They kept questioning him. He straightened up. Another spatial transliteration. He straightened up and said to them, look, I tell you what, you're right. If you want to go by what you believe, you do what you got to do. But first, I know what the law says. I know what the law says. Because see, we love the letter of the law, but not the spirit of the law. If any one of you is without sin, let him be the first to throw a stone. Do what you gotta do. But you better check yourself when you wreck yourself. Because don't nobody in here know what you've done for me. Y'all all caught her in here for what she did. There goes the woman. There goes the stones. Go ahead. You better think about where you were last night, where you were last Friday, how many drinks you had, did you get drive home? You better think about that lie that you told, that gossip that you spread, that company that you keep, that fourth husband that you have. You better think about all that. What you trying to say, Jeremy? Be careful, cast six stones. Because everybody in here had a stone to throw and a stone to take. And if we start casting stones, we play spiritual dodgeball in here. You don't need no rocks, you need some righteousness. Therefore, when we stand before Jesus, we should be worried about what somebody else is doing or is not doing. We ought to be focusing our attention on Him. Some of us come to church every Sunday in the presence of the Lord, and we're looking at everybody else, what they doing, what they thinking, what they wear, how they act. I ain't worried about you, I'm worried about God. Well, you know she ain't nobody. You know what she like. I don't care what she like. I don't care what she do. I don't care about trouble. I don't come to church for that. I come to church to be in the presence of the Lord. I have enough darkness in my life where I just want to stand before the light before I die. And you, God.
Say it, Jeremy. Say it.
What you got going on don't concern me. I don't care. Somebody ought to love the Lord enough to come here for no other reason but to sit in His presence and receive His teaching and become better people. Why are you so passionate about that? Because I'm going to tell you, we ain't got time for rumors. We ain't got time for drama. We ain't got time for clicks. We ain't got time for nothing. It's time for folk to be worried about Jesus. I don't care what George is about. Well, you know I've been here 25 years, and you know what George used to be. I don't care what George used to be. I don't keep your folks family. I don't know what those times. And folk, I tell you something else, he says, Martin, well, you know you didn't preach a long time. I know I did. The Bible and the Word of God is to be a mirror and not a telescope. Some of us use the Bible as a telescope and then find it falsely as a kaleidoscope. Because we see in the other folks' lives clearly, but when it's reflected to us in a kaleidoscope, we see it with rose-colored glasses. The Bible and my knowledge of the Word of God is not for Marvin, it's for me! Look at me! There's enough junk in my life and your life and their life that we don't have to worry about what other folk are doing. I'm done. The Bible says he then wrote on the ground again. What was he writing? The three schools of thought. The first school of thought is that he was writing gibberish. I don't believe that because Jesus don't waste his time. Secondary point is, well, maybe Jesus was writing in a foreign language. Could have been that because they heard and saw. So it's something they can understand. The third school of thought, which brings both credence to the text, is that he was writing their sins on the ground in front of them. You ever want to shut somebody up? That wasn't the best way to say that, but that's how I said it. You ever want to shut somebody up? Write down their past in their present. Some of us, though, we don't act like it, need a whole notebook and a five subject notebook to write our past and our present. The party was over, Curtis, when folks started seeing their online passwords. When folks started seeing their conversations on the telephone. When folks started seeing their destinations when they were 25, now they're 65. You know how I know that? Because the Bible says the oldest folk left first. Number one, man, we don't like old folk. Number one, because seasoned saints got more sense. Number two, the longer you live, the more you done done. See, grandma didn't always have peppermints and rubber stops. That's why when we have church, grandma gets the highest praise, and the 14-year-old just don't understand. Jesus and the woman left, the woman still doing what? Standing there. I think somebody missed that. The woman still what? Standing there. All this has happened. And spatially, she never moved. You want to know what the preaching point is? You better learn how to be still. She didn't do nothing. She didn't say nothing. But everything worked out in her favor. She didn't do like most of us out there. She didn't pop her neck and say, "Your eyes, what y'all got me doing here? Well, brother, where my quail at? I don't know. I'm sitting here listening to her." She knew who she was standing in front of, and she stood still. Yeah. She's still standing. Verse 10. In verse 10, whenever it gets on the screen, in verse 10, Jesus straightened up and asked a woman, "What is it?" This is the first time he asked a question. Has no one condemned you? Verse 11. This is the first time she ever talked. She's a woman of few words. But with Jesus, he might kind of say a whole lot of words. No one said. Three words. And neither do I condemn you. Go now and leave your life. You said, "I can't finish it like I want to, but I do want to tell you this." You get the rest of my office. They need to do I. We want her to be found guilty. We want Rodney to be found guilty. Brother Ray to be found guilty.
Well,
Jesus says, "Look, I don't condone what you do. We don't serve a God who condones sin. Right. But we serve a God who gives us another chance."
Yeah.
I'm not going to condemn you. Meaning what? I'm not going to judge you to finality because your life is not over.
Right.
Your decision does not always mean your direction.
Right.
There's more after this. Go now and leave your life of sin.
Right.
You're not guilty and you show up as innocent.
Right.
But the case is dismissed. Why? Because your witnesses never came to trial, right? They left you in the place that you left you in the first place. And that's with me and me alone. Because I am the judge.
Yeah.
Let me tell you something. The judgeship and the judge seat is not for two people, it's for one.
Yeah.
Let's be standing and not sitting. Let's be standing and not sitting. I ain't finished, but I better be through.
We want to thank you for joining us for another episode of Good News from the Gray. We invite you at your earliest opportunity to join us here at the Gray Road Church of Christ. At the Gray Road Church, you will find a biblically based, loving, and authentic body of believers in a multi-generational environment. We are located here in the Spring Grove community at 4826 Gray Road, Cincinnati, Ohio, 45232. Or we invite you to join us on our website, www.grayroadchurchofchrist.org, or please join us on our Facebook page, Instagram page, and Twitter page at your earliest convenience. We look forward to seeing you grow at the Gray.
You got your reward.
Thanks, God. We've got a warning for you today. If you're looking for the praises of
man,
Jesus said these sad words. You've already got your reward. I'll tell them the story.
The Pharisees stood on the streets when they prayed. They would say the same prayers over and over again. Oh, for a show to be seen by men. Jesus said, "Don't you follow in their ways, doing good deeds, seeking other men's praises. Their pursuit of life is earthly fortune and fame, but in the end is all in vain." Jesus said these words.